Just about my favorite thing in .NET Core, certainly in Entity Framework Core, is the in-memory database, because it really makes your life much, much easier when you're trying to unit test against a system that normally runs with the database. I'm going to split this video into two parts. First part, I'm going to show you the reasons why an in-memory database is such a good thing and how it works. And then the second part, just a few of the caveats and pitfalls to really make best use of it. So let's take a look at the program I put together. What I've got here is fairly simple ASP.NET MVC website. I've got a couple of entities. I've got this book here with a title and a year of publication, and then a reference to an author. And then I've got an author which has a name and then a collection of books by that author. So we've got a two-way references there that obviously in the database are going to be handled by a foreign key, but in Entity Framework and in code, they're handled by references and collections. I've then got a DB context, so pretty straightforward what we've got there connecting to the database. But then for testing, I don't want to be directly injecting my DB context into the controller, because then we'd always be running against the database. So I've used the repository pattern instead. So I have an interface called iLibrary Repository, which gives us access to the books and the authors. It also allows us to add a new entity and to save changes to commit things to the database. For completeness, we should also really have a delete entity in there, but just to keep things simple, we can miss that out. And then we implement that repository in two ways. For the real use of it, we have a DB repository, so implements that interface, has the actual library context, the DB context, injected into it, and then just delegates each one of those methods and properties down to the corresponding one in the library context. But then on the other side of things, in our test project, here we have the mock repository, and that again implements the same interface, but in this case, we've had to just have in-memory lists of books and authors. We can access those by converting them to queryables. You'll have seen in an earlier video, I was explaining why you've got to use iQueryable here rather than iEnumerable. We've got an add method that just determines what type of entity it is and puts it into the appropriate collection. And then save changes does absolutely nothing at all, because this is all in memory when we're doing our unit testing. And the way we configure that then is in our normal running in startup. You can see we've declared that we want to inject the DB repository whenever anyone asks the interface. And then we're also configuring the context to use SQL Server. Whereas in the test code, you can see that we just create this mock repository and no DB context, pass that into the controller, and that's what we're going to use. And then our controller finally accepts just the interface. And so the code will either be using the mock repository or the DB repository, whichever one we go for. But let's highlight the differences now. So in here, I've got an index that just displays all of the books and authors, and then not particularly realistic because I've got a create that doesn't actually take data in from the user. We just hard coded it to create an author, Jane Austen, and a book called Emma, and add that into the data store via the repository. But I'm doing it that way so we can really highlight now the differences in behavior that we get between a real database through the DB context and our mock repository. So let's pop a break in there and then run up the application. And then we'll go to that create sample, which will hit our breakpoint. And then if we just step over the first two statements, we've created in memory our author and our book. But if we look at those in the debugger, then we can see a couple of interesting things about them. Obviously, we've got the name of the author, but the ID is set to zero, so that hasn't been given a value. And also our collection of books is currently null. Whereas if we look at the book, we can see also it's not got an ID yet, but because we put the author straight in there, so the book knows who its author is, but the author doesn't yet know what its books are. If we then step over and do the add to the repository, which will add to the DB context and the save changes, and then we look at our objects again, now we can see that our book for example, now has a valid ID, which has been generated by the database. And also our author now has a collection of books that contains the book that we wanted. So what Entity Framework has done for us through the DB context is it's fixed up all those details as you'd expect a database to do. And then at the end of that, we just redirect to the index and we get the books and authors listed out there. If we contrast that though with what's happened with our mock data, so let's go to our controller tests, and here we can see we're just calling that create directly from a test method. So if we go to our test explorer, we can see we've already got a failure in there on that test. So let's debug that test. And then we hit the breakpoint. And if we just go through the same process again, at this stage, it's just the same. We can see that the ID hasn't been set and we've got no books. But when we step over, now we hit the problem because this is just in-memory data and we've done nothing special to deal with it. We still have no ID. We still have no collection of books. And this is the limitation of writing a mock repository in the way that I've done it, that it doesn't do some of the things that a database would do. And so ultimately, if we just step back to the tests, we can see that although we've got the books okay, when we start looking for authors, for example, that's not properly been set up. And so that's where we're getting our exception that gives us the red light. And so what I find I end up doing is actually writing a far more complicated mock repository that has to deal with all of those issues. So some of them are relatively simple, like every time we add an entity, make sure we just give it a unique ID. That can be written in a fairly general purpose way. But all of those fix-ups, like the fact that when a book has a reference to an author, the author also has to have a reference back to the book. You need to put those in there to make the tests work, but they are very, very specific, and you just find yourself writing lots and lots of special cases for each and every association that you have. And that's really the big benefit of the in-memory database, that it's still not dealing with the database directly, but it does that sort of work for you. And it's very simple to introduce. First thing we need to do is just make sure we add an additional NuGet package. So if we look at our test project and look at the installed packages, we can see that amongst the other things, we've got Microsoft.EntityFrameworkCore.InMemory. So along with the other Entity Framework packages that you've got to add, make sure that you've got that one in there as well. And then the code, which I've written earlier, is this get in memory repository that we're not using yet. But the main thing we do is we set up our DB context options for using the in-memory database. So it's very, very similar to what we had in startup when we're configuring it to use SQL Server, but here we're configuring it to use an in-memory database, and then we just give the in-memory database a name to identify it. Call that whatever you like. You can have multiple databases coexisting in memory as long as you give them different names, but I've just called that MockDB. We then use that to pass into the options to our library context. So the thing to notice here is we are using the DB context. So when we had our own mock repository, we completely bypassed the DB context, but now we do have the context, and then we pass that into the real repository. So that DB repository is the one that we were using in the real code, and our mock repository, in fact, we could now delete. We're not going to be using that at all. So that's what we do, and that gives us back a repository. And then the repository we can inject into the controller in just the same way. So all I need to do here is change this from using the mock repository to using this in-memory repository. And if we run the test again, we see that we're getting green lights. So it seems to have fixed the problems. Let's debug that so we can see what's actually going on. So we hit the breakpoint again. This time though, when we step over, we still obviously have no books and no ID, and no ID there. But now because we're using the in-memory database, not our simple collection of objects, now if we look, we can see that we do have a collection of books, that we do have IDs, and so although it's still all in memory, it's working just like a real database. And so that means it's ideal for unit testing. It means we're in control of our data. Just to remind you of the problem with unit testing through to a database, it means that if someone happens to change the data in the database, that means our tests are going to fail and we're going to get red lights. Even though it's nothing wrong with the software, it's simply that the software is processing different data and therefore you get different results. Whereas here, the database is completely under our control. It's completely recreated on each run of the tests. So there's no risk of that sort of thing going on. And also the other advantage is it's faster because you don't have to make the connection through to the real database. So that's the basic way of doing it. We can create our in-memory database very, very simply and get all of those benefits. One thing you may have noticed is that we now don't need the repository at all. We've already got rid of the mock repository. And so at the moment, we're injecting the DB repository into the controller every time and just making things different by configuring the DB context, either with a real database or an in-memory database. And so you could completely eliminate the repository and simply put the DB context directly into the controller, both when you're testing and when you're running. But something to bear in mind is there are actually two reasons people like to use repositories. One is what we've seen here, so you can switch between the mock repository and the real repository. Well, we've eliminated that. But the other reason people like to use it is to encapsulate their queries. So if you've got a number of quite complicated queries, let's say very often you want to list books between certain years, so everything in, say, from 1800 to 1900, something like that, you may not want to have to be writing link all over your code. So you may, in your repository, have a method called getBooksInRange, and that isolates the link code. And that's the second reason for having a repository. And not everybody's worried about that, but if you are concerned about that, then it's still worth having the repository, even though you no longer need the mock repository. There's a link to all that code below, and I'll be following up very shortly with another video just pointing out a few of the tips and tricks that can be useful when we're using these in-memory databases for testing.